Penguin Random House Audio presents Vacationland, True Stories from Painful Beaches. This is the author speaking to you. My name is John Hodgman. This book is dedicated to Eileen Callahan Hodgman. This is the beginning. The bookkeeper for the Church of Satan. First of all, I apologize for my beard. Not only because it is terrible, thin, patchy, and asymmetrical, but also because it is inexplicable. Many people have asked me why I grew it, and most of those people are my wife. And to them and to her, I say, I don't know, and I'm sorry. Before my beard, I just had a mustache, and that was not mysterious at all. In fact, I have grown two mustaches in my life, for equally banal and emotionally transparent reasons. I grew the first one in 1999 in the year-long run-up to my marriage to the woman who is still my wife. I had only ever been clean-shaven before then, aside from an obligatory early 90s flirtation with a soul patch in college. And I suppose now I was testing her. A few very good-looking people I know turn mean when they drink, mocking and abusing the people who care about them. They make themselves ugly to see if people will still love them that way. I think my mustache, thick and dark and unwanted in the middle of my round, pale face, served the same function, to be repulsive on purpose. I looked like a bushy 19th century president who also happened to be a baby. Luckily, my then fiancé, whom I have known since high school and who had already seen me through various thicks and thins, did not take the bait. She did not confirm my fear that I was an unlovable fraud, and did not decline to marry President Chester A. Baby. So I shaved off my mustache the morning after my bachelor weekend in a dilapidated mansion in Atlantic City that I had rented with a group of friends. I cannot remember whether this was my decision or her command. Maintaining such fogginess about free will is, I think, a secret to a lasting marriage. And ours has lasted. You have the numbers in front of you, so you can do the math. I've never been very good with subtraction, especially with odd numbers, like 1999 and 2017. I grew my second and currently enduring mustache in 2011. By that time, my wife and I had two children, whose actual names will never be revealed. As you know, I've always hesitated to talk about my children and, when pressed, would refer to our daughter only as Hodgmina and our son as Hodgmanillo. In the past, I've said this is to protect their privacy, and that is true of our son, who is, as of this writing, still young enough to like us. There are many joys of parenting, but ultimately, we are robots, training our own upgrades to replace us. But my son doesn't know this yet. He doesn't know that his job is to grow and thrive apart from us and conspire with time in our destruction. He still holds our hands and does not treat us like we are hopelessly stupid, and so I wish to protect him. But Hodgmina is now a luminously smart teenager with a strong social media presence who I think would enjoy being named in this book, so I am keeping her anonymous to spite her. I love her. I hope, of course, that she will outlive me. These are the kind of fun hopes you nurture when you get older. But I do not need to help her outpace me in fame. Insecurely teasing a teenager is a privilege of fatherhood. And I grew my second mustache for the same reason all your weird dads grew theirs. It is an evolutionary signal that says, I'm all done. A mustache sends a visual message to the mating population of Earth that says, no thank you. I have procreated. My DNA is out in the world, and so I no longer deserve physical affection. Instead, it is time for me to turn away from sex and toward new pursuits, the classic weird dad hobbies such as puns and learning trivia about bridges and wars and dreaming about societal collapse and global apocalypse. All dads dream about the end of the world. It is a comfort to them. For some, the fantasy is blunt, vengeful, and aspirational. The zombie epidemic story, as one example, is consistently popular for a very clear and simple reason. When chaos consumes civilization, you get to start over. You get to be young again. All your debts, real and emotional, are canceled. Whatever your dumb job used to be, it has now been replaced with the sole exciting occupation of survival via crossbow or samurai sword. You get to dress up and wear armor or an eye patch. And since your neighbors now have been transformed into the idiot monsters you always believed them to be, the zombie epidemic offers you finally moral permission to shoot them in the head. This is not my fantasy, by the way. Now, I've always thought that if The Walking Dead really wanted to provoke horror, its last season would time jump 5 years to a future in which the government reforms and the zombies have been cured, aside from the ones that our heroes decapitated. And all the characters have to get those dumb jobs again, and the humans will have to work alongside the horribly mutilated, cured zombies, and think about what they did and what they became in order to survive. And they think about this while they all sit around in the break room together with their reheated soups. That said, I don't want to sound snobby about zombies. I get it. If there were a zombie show that just featured the characters endlessly raiding supermarkets for canned goods and then stocking those cans neatly back in their compound pantry, I would watch that for 19 seasons. Guns and power and the weird masculine redemption fantasy of white dudes getting back to running things has never meant as much to me as abundant, well-organized food. The apocalypse I dreamed of was different and presented a different kind of consolation. I was in the Pioneer Valley, in the western part of my home Commonwealth of Massachusetts, an important place in my life. I was sitting in the Montague Book Mill, a used bookstore inside a creaky old sawmill that looks about to collapse into the shallow little river that once powered it. This was where I had written a lot of my first two books, and I was now trying to start another. But I was having trouble because I had just realized that I was not going to live forever. This thought had never occurred to me before. I am a straight white man, the hero of almost every story I had ever encountered. And what's more, I'm an only child. The idea that the world could continue without me was not only unimaginable, it was insulting. But in that moment, something shifted. I was upstairs at the book mill, alone, sitting at a nicked wooden table before two open windows, their glass wavy with age. The door behind me was open and full of sun, the ancient eaves above me cold with summer shadow. The little river giggled outside as it slowly consumed its rocky foundation. I was halfway through my 40th year. Mustache 2 was in graying bloom, and I was writing a book in a used bookstore, exactly where books go to die. And then it was a physical sensation that I remember. Suddenly I was gripped, just above my stomach, by the dumb, offensive truth. Everything ends. Nothing lasts. Not even John Hodgman. This is a truth so obvious that we build whole world religions, grandly spangled with art and rituals and distracting hypocrisies, in order to avoid thinking about it. And if we do not succumb to religion or myth, we tell ourselves other wild stories to make us feel better. The story I started that day was That Is All, the last book I wrote before this one. It was the third in a trilogy of fake facts and invented history that I originally wrote for a general audience, but had found a particular following among strange 13-year-olds. So I thought I would treat those kids to a comedy book about everyone on Earth dying all at once. Now, I know that sounds like a big literary innovation, but the truth was the end times were trending. Everyone was talking about how the ancient Mayans had calculated that the world would end in December 2012. I just added some other equally plausible elements: a giant ravaging swarm of stray dogs, a massive tsunami of blood, and eventually the Earth cracking in half to release a giant magical toad at its center on 12/21/12. Nothing you wouldn't find in any bad Google translation of the Book of Revelation, but it comforted me. Unlike the zombie apocalypse, global annihilation offered a different, better comfort. Not that I could escape death, But then when I died, I got to take everyone else out with me. I may not have been there at the beginning of creation, but I would be there to turn the lights off. And this just felt right. You may have noticed the world did not end on December 21st, 2012, as the Mayans and I predicted. Very embarrassing. I blame the Mayans.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.